Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick in the Philippines, trying to get myself situated here, get a good view. I can't really, I had to move because of, rearranged the room here, had some leaking in the ceiling because of all the heavy rains we've been having. Of course, you know, the old house, we had the ceiling leak too. I thought, one reason why I moved, well, I had to move because the landlord was going to do something else with the house, but I look forward to moving to a little bit better house than the old one, and one benefit I thought would be the fact that it wouldn't be leaking anymore, but I found out that it's still leaking. Well, what can you do? Brothers and sisters, there's lots of things the Lord's been showing me, and I'm still meditating on the meaning of that, and so I haven't been able to really make a video about it. The Lord's been giving me lots of showing me things and night visions. When I say night vision, if you haven't seen my videos, like Daniel had visions in the night, and people say, oh, that's dreams. Well, a dream is when you're asleep, but you can be awake at night and then like still have your eyes closed and laying there and then see a vision. So you're awake and it's a vision in the night while you're just laying there and you just either woke up or you're going to sleep. Different than maybe a vision while you're praying. Now, I guess while I'm on the topic, I will say that there's something called a open vision, closed vision. And so closed vision is with your eyes closed, and open vision is like you're really in it. It's like a movie, just like with dreams. You can have a dream that you are watching a TV and seeing things, or you can, it's not the same as open and closed vision, but on being in it, you can have a dream that like you're in the dream and you're like acting in the dream. And it's like you're looking through your own eyes and you're walking around in the dream, or you can like see it like a TV screen. So there's different levels. And that's not really the video intended on doing, but I just throwing it out there, FYI, because, you know, the Lord used me to help people, those little things, to try to understand what's going on with them. You can have an impression. As I mentioned as an example, practical example, discernment of spirits. Every unanointed person, lots of unanointed people message me and they say, well, you know, I have discernment. I have discernment, and I know by my discernment that this preacher is wrong. He's a false preacher, blah, 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 and this one is a good preacher. I know this by discernment. And in reality, it's not really about discerning in the fact that lots of people say those things. We don't need to discern if someone is a false prophet or not, or if someone is a false teacher, because we have the Word of God. So if they're teaching something that doesn't match the Word of God, then of course then we can say, yeah, they're teaching falsely. Now, if they make a mistake is one thing, and being a false teacher is another. So in other words, a false teacher is telling you a different gospel. Bottom line, the Apostle Paul said, if we himself or the apostles or an angel from heaven tell you a different gospel than the one that we already gave you, let them be accursed. And I say again, let them be anathema is the word he uses. Let them be anathema, which means to be accursed. Let them be, you know, shunned. Let them be go to hell, you know, let them be cursed. So accursed is a way of saying it in English. So that's how you do that. But the term, the spiritual gift from 1 Corinthians chapter 12, discernment of spirits, is being able to see or hear or smell or feel into the spirit world. So it's not like saying this guy's good and that guy's, this guy's a bad teacher, this guy's a good teacher, this person's a nice person, this person is a bad person. That's not discernment of spirits. You know, that's judging someone's character based on the things they say and do. So that's totally different, but people always get that confused. So as an example, as I was getting to, I had a little bit of a pastoral thing going on there by correcting people for judging people and calling it discernment of spirits. And discernment of spirits is like, I've mentioned this example, those who watch my videos, I have a sister-in-law who was my first translator when I was started operating in Mindanao in the Philippines, when I first time I came here, 2005 to Mindanao. So it's been 9 years since I came to this island. But I went to other parts of the Philippines the year before that, maybe. Yeah. So anyway, 2005, she translated for me. Anyway, we ran into these people who were demon-possessed. They made a pact with the devil. They had put this chicken blood and all this that the Japanese would find gold. There's Japanese people come all around the Philippines, claiming they'll share the profits with the local people if they let them dig for the, during World War II. It's supposed to be all these, there's a rumors or whatever that these Japanese generals or admirals or whatever hid this gold in the Philippines. Everywhere you go, every village in the whole Philippines, they'll say, oh, the gold is buried here. I mean, how much gold was there? Maybe it was a one-time deal somewhere in the Philippines, like wherever. And, you know, so anyway, so there's been hundreds of sites where the Japanese venture capitalists have actually came here and dug all around here. And anyway, so the local people in this one area, they made a pact with the devil, really. I mean, they sacrificed these chickens, they had a witch doctor come, and they sacrificed chickens and all this, that the gold would be found there, and they would all be rich. So the weird thing about this possession, I've talked about this before, every day at like 2 p.m., because Filipinos, coming from being a Spanish colony, they take a siesta. Here they call it pahuay. They take a rest in the afternoon, like from 1 to 3 o'clock. So like 90% of Filipinos sleep between 1 and 3 o'clock. Kind of like, you know, what they do, I guess, in all Spanish countries. Anyway, so during that time, like around 2 o'clock, the whole group of these people, they would be attacked by demons. There was like 8 of them, at least 8 that I know about, in the village who were attacked at the same time. And white spirits, they call them white ladies, these evil-looking, white, ghost-looking women, feminine creatures, spirits, demons, would try to drag them out of their bodies and take them and bury them underground and kill them, you know, and their spirit was taken out of their body. And one of the guys was even, he would come up off the bed, his family would try to hold him down and all this stuff. And anyway, so when we went there, my first translator there, it turned out to be my sister-in-law, because I ended up, that's how I met my wife, through my translator. Anyway, so my translator, she could smell this foul smell. So she had a smell. That was discernment of spirits. She smelt the foul smell of this demon. And she knew that the person that we were talking to was demon-possessed. And then, because we were just going around doing evangelism, and then we just stumbled into this situation. She had smelled it. But the thing about it is, before she said anything, the Lord spoke to me and said, see, I didn't have discernment of spirits in this case, even though God has given me discernment of spirit a few times. I've seen into the spirit world, but not smelling. Mine was, I saw demons on people. But in this case, I didn't see a demon on this woman. This case, I got a word of knowledge, one of the other gifts from 1 Corinthians chapter 12. The Lord spoke to me and said, this woman is demon-possessed, and I want you to cast a demon out of her. You know, while the woman, we were interacting with her, we had a translator, my sister-in-law, future sister-in-law, was translating for me. So they were talking, and I was just sitting there. You know, whenever you're in a foreign country, you can't speak the language, especially in a remote area where it takes, I mean, the average person there probably only went to the first or second grade. I mean, it takes a long time to explain to them just the basics of the gospel. I mean, you know, it's not something that you just boom, boom, boom. It's a slow process. So I'm sitting there most of the time anyway, looking stupid, you know, and, going along with the slow process. So while I'm sitting there, the Lord just spoke to me and said, hey, the woman's demon-possessed. I want you to cast it out. And then I didn't say anything because my future sister-in-law was talking to her in their local language, which I can now understand completely and speak okay, speak conversationally. And the translator turned to me and said, this woman must be demon-possessed. I said, why do you say that? She said, because I smell this odor that I always smell, like sulfur smell, when there's a demon. So this woman has a demon in her. And I said, well, the Lord, that's true, because the Lord just told me that she has a demon and he wants us to cast it out. So that's how God operates. It was confirmed between us. You know. And then she asked, I told her to ask the woman what's going on. We found out about the pact. So I got the village together and I evangelized a large group of them, including their leaders, and told them, hey, this is demonic, this chicken blood thing and all that. They need to repent of it, and God will deliver the village. And so we prayed for each individual. We went around and we asked who's all the people. We went to all of them, prayed for them to be delivered. We told them, don't let this quack doctor, they call him here quack doctor, the witch doctor, come around anymore. And that witch doctor, everywhere I went, it was the same. There's lots of witch doctors in the Philippines, and there's one particular powerful witch doctor, which I've never met him in person. It's an old man, and I know the place he lives. It's called the Fishing Village. Kind of a common name, isn't it, Sonny? He lives in a place called the Fishing Village in Davao del Sur. And I never met him in person, but I've seen his damage all over the place, and I've delivered. God has used me to cast demons out of, you know, do deliverance with maybe a dozen people affected by this one witch doctor. And I told all of them, you know, and, but of course the witch doctor hasn't messed with me by the grace of God, protected by the angels of the Most High God. You know, I just wanted to say this too. I'm just thinking about it. You know, there's lots of people that didn't see this video and haven't seen my videos and in America, and they think they know something about spirits. If you want to be involved in spiritual warfare, I advise you to go to a third world country like the Philippines. Down in Central America and all those former Spanish or Portuguese colonies that have a history of, you know, they were colonies and they also have a history of Roman Catholicism, you know, as their religion there. Because everywhere the Catholic Church went, they just incorporated the local traditions right in. I mean, that's really, you know, the videos I've been making about the thousand shades of gray and all that. So in other words, Catholicism in the Philippines is different than Catholicism in Mexico and everywhere else. Like in Mexico, they have Our Lady of Guadalupe. You know, here they have the baby Jesus, Señor Santo Niño. As a matter of fact, I went out 2 days ago to do my running. If those of you who watch my videos, you know that I go running 3 times a week. And I try to evangelize and visit people when I go out, stop along the way and drink water. They have these water pumps. You know, you pump the water out of the ground in these what they call squatter areas, where the people who are squatters there, really, they're just hanging, you know, they're, you know, squatting on government land or vacant land that's really dangerous. That's why these people get killed all the time, because they squat around the edge of the river. There's a big storm, there's a flood, and then, you know, they all get wiped out to sea. Maybe a couple hundred people were killed because they're just squatting there. It's not a place that people should be building, and the government lets them do it because they're, you know, they don't have anything. And they just turn a blind eye to this people because the government's not helping them in any way, and, you know, that's how it is. Anyway, so this is the area where the quack doctors target, of course. But there's rich people that go to the quack doctors too, but believe it or not, educated people. But more mainly, it's your poverty-stricken people and uneducated. Never even going to school at all, maybe first, second, third grade, and they can't hardly read and write. These fishermen and stuff like that, and their families, farmers and fishermen. But anyway, they were having the Senior Santo Niño. That's the senior baby Jesus. There's the regular Santo Niño, it's supposed to be baby Jesus, and then there's the, like, a toddler. This kind of a new God they added about 10 or 20 years ago. It's a new one. It's like a toddler. They call him Senior Santo Niño. So, what's today? Okay, so yesterday, maybe it was, that was their Senior Santo Niño worship day. And I've seen lots of different things. Like in Manila, they had the Black Nazarene Day, and they people get trampled and killed, and they just have drunken debauchery. So this one, I mean, they're all the same. It's like in the Bible when you read the story about, you know, when Moses went up to the top of the hill and they built the golden calves, it says they got drunk, they rose up to play, and basically they had drunken revelry, and actually, if you read the text, it's a euphemism for they actually had an orgy. So all of this evil comes out of idol worship. And I guess that's, I need to make a different video about duality, but this one I'm talking about, spiritual warfare and deliverance and idolatry. And the Apostle Paul tells us that people who do sacrifices to idols are doing sacrifices to demons. So that's what the Apostle Paul told us, which makes absolute sense. Of course that's what it is. There's a demonic spirit behind all of this, Our Lady of Guadalupe, all these different ones. Like as an example, the Our Lady of Guadalupe, the story behind it is, it's like it was a native guy who was working for the priest, and he had like some image on his chest or something. And then later on they said, oh, this is, looks like the Virgin Mary, so Our Lady of Guadalupe. It's they have these idols all over the world, these different gods. And so anyway, this Senior Santo Niño is typical. Now what had happened is to tell you how I just stumbled into it. I went down to where I normally go, and then I was going along the beach, and then I cut through these different squatter areas. I noticed that there was not a single person at this beach area where there's normally some people. And I was like, what's going on? There's not a single soul out here. It was kind of strange. So then let me tell you what happened. This is how idolatry works. This is how, you know, when people get into that drunken revelry, the level of satanic darkness rises, just like with the golden calf thing. So, and I've seen it 1,000 times after this is my 7th year here in the Philippines. I've seen it 1,000 times. It is so very real and so very true. You see the fruit of this satanic spirit, this demonic spirit of these idols. So I'm going down the beach, and then I start passing these young women, maybe in groups of 2 or 3. They're only like 14 years old, maybe 13, 14, 15, 16. Young, high school age girls, and they're all saying things to me that they normally would not say. That's in a, you know, a flirtation, very flirtatious and all this. Now, normally, you'd once every 6 months when I'm running, there'll be a woman who might say something to me because, you know, I'm the only foreigner here, and they'll say, hey, Joe, you know, do you have a wife? Something like that, you know, and make a joke and stuff like that. Usually nothing, no big deal. But these girls, all of them that I passed, like, and they weren't even near each other. They didn't hear each other. They were all saying things to me that were very flirtatious and very aggressively bad. And these are just teenage girls. So the first two did, there was two of them walking together and they said something to me. And that's really rare, like I said, especially teenagers. Maybe only once or twice in 7 years I've been here I saw that. And so, well, with these fests. So anyway, this festival. So I went on and then two, there was a couple more, they did it again. And then the third time and I said, you know what? There's got to be an idol worshiping fiesta going on somewhere nearby. Because these girls, and they're not drinking, these are teenagers, they were not drinking. They are hypersexualized at this moment. So there's only one, and you know, I'm a pastor, and I'm a Christian. And so, you know, this has got to be the Satan. It's only one source of this situation, it's got to be the devil. You know. So I kept on going, and then I heard all this shouting and carrying on. Then they were having this great big rooster fight, or cock fight, you know. There was hundreds of people. Now, if you said you were going to have an evangelism crusade in the Philippines, the only people who show up is the handful of Christians in the local place. The Philippines is only about 5% born-again Christian. So if I had said, hey, I'm going to have a big evangelism crusade downtown, I would get all the, you know, if I could get all the local churches to support me, I would get a crowd of people. But they would all be Christians, you know, and they, you know, they weren't going to be hooping and hollering and jumping up and down. But here, you can hear them hooping and hollering and getting crazy, and there's hundreds of people. Well, they're having some rooster fights. You know, they're all fired up about that. And which is nothing wrong. You know, that's what they do here. You know, I know it's illegal now in the States, I think, but a few states. I think it's Louisiana or somewhere else that's illegal. Maybe Arkansas. It was. I don't know if it still is. But anyway, I mean, in itself, you know, I don't have any problem with them having rooster fights. But, of course, it's all about gambling and getting drunk. I mean, that's the thing about it. And then they start fighting. So there were fights going on. They're drunk, gambling, and then they have all of this gambling stuff, different gambling going on, all the places, drinking, a disco, all of this in front of their little temple, their idol temple. Every neighborhood has a patron saint, and the patron saint of one of these neighborhoods, there's some of them are different. There's San Isidore, there's the Black Nazarene, there's lots of different ones. There's Senior Santo Niño, the regular Santo Niño, then there's, you know, Our Lady of Guadalupe, they have some of those here. And then there's the Blessed Virgin, the Immaculate Conception, whatever, all these different idols and orders of nuns and priests that worship these different gods. You know, there's the Immaculate Heart of Mary, the Immaculate Heart of Christ, whatever, blah, blah, blah. So anyway, this idol and this one of these places I go through is the Senior of Santo Niño. So in front of their little idol chapel, they have a little chapel in every neighborhood. The Catholics put little chapels in every neighborhood to counteract the evangelical movement, you know, because the evangelical movement has been trying to, you know, explode in all of these former Catholic countries, or Catholic countries, and so of course they put these little chapels, they call them GKK chapels, on every little neighborhood, and then there's a patron saint for every neighborhood. So their god in this neighborhood is the Senior Santo Niño. So they have a little idol there, they have their big statue, they bring it out, they all rub it, kiss it, touch it with a rag, and then touch people that are sick and all that. I mean, they worship it. I don't care what any Catholics try to tell you. They worship these idols here in the Philippines and all these third world countries. I'm telling you, go watch the videos on YouTube, whatever, you will see they do it. No doubt, to worship is to venerate, to honor, to bow down to. They cry, weep, touch it. You know, it's a god. You know, they have a parade and all that. So after the parade, you know, they're all liquored up, partying, gambling, they have a disco in front of their little idol temple. They have a disco, and they're out there doing all this dirty dancing and all that stuff right in front of their idol. I mean, you know, for them, they think it's somehow part of Jesus, that's somehow part of God. And even if they, which it's not, but let's just say that it was. They're having drunken revelry, sexualization, all of this wild party and gambling and cockfights, and they even have horse fights in some places, all this stuff. In the name of God? I mean, how is that honoring God? That's the bottom line. It's not. That just shows you the fruit of the fact that it's satanic. It's demonic. Just as Paul said, When you offer an offering to an idol, you are offering it to a demon. And that is a fact. Why? Look at the fruit. Look at the fruit. I'm going to cut off this video. So we're talking about this spiritual discernment. And I want to do a video on dualities, as the Lord, as I've done lots of those. And it's a very interesting topic. And the Lord keeps dropping that stuff on me. Let me do one on dualities. And I know lots of people will watch. This one, maybe not so many views. But it's interesting. And people can learn about Satan and how he operates. And particularly in a country like the Philippines. And other third world, former Spanish colonies slash where the conquistadors brought in, of course, and mixed Christianity with the local pagan religions. The result is what we have here, a non-functioning society. That's why millions of Filipinos go abroad, and the remittance since they sit back here is what supports the country, because the country is basically without the overseas workers, and the remittance, this country has no economy. And there's lots of countries like that. And it's sad, it's a shame. And then, like, if Filipinos want to leave the Philippines, they can't get on a plane and leave. I mean, they have to have all this documentation and paperwork. They're prisoners here. They can't escape. And like an American, hey, I can go out of the country. Canadians and people like that, we can get on a plane and fly to lots of countries. Filipinos can't do that. And without all this visas, and they have to show it and prove it and all that. And it's a huge hassle. Anyway, brothers and sisters, that's why we need to bring Jesus here. That's why we need evangelism here. So these people will get the curse of idolatry lifted off of them. As I prophesied by the Spirit of the Lord in 2005, a word from the Lord that, just like in Amos, where God says, because you worship idols that cannot hear and cannot speak, cannot see, I will make you like your idols, where you cannot hear and you cannot see and you cannot speak. And God has put a deaf and dumb spirit on these countries. And that's what's got to be broken in this country. I ask you to pray about that and come in agreement with me that all the work I do here will be to break that deaf and dumb spirit off the people, that they might hear the gospel with their hearts, that it will penetrate, that they will have an ear to hear. God bless you guys.